Shalom, family, and welcome to a very special program here in Israel. I'm Nate, and we have an amazing show for you all today that is going to inspire you in your walk with God. Now, of all the Gospels, 89 total chapters, only 4 offer any information about the life of Jesus before the beginning of his public ministry. We know practically nothing about Jesus' first 29 hidden chapters of life. Only 3 years, less than 10% of Jesus' days are visible through the writings of the Bible. That's over 90% of his earthly life is submerged in the unseen. Now, very little is known about Jesus' upbringing during his childhood, so we took a special trip to the Nazareth village to gain some information on just this. This 3-acre site is a reproduction of the village where Jesus grew up. Costumed from the time of Jesus, we learned how animals were kept, where people lived, and where Jesus worshiped in the synagogue. Now, join us in the Nazareth village as we embark on an incredible journey, discover the unhidden, and see how people lived during the time of Jesus. Take a look.
From Adam to Eve, creation has been seen, to a son, to a sheep. He will forever reign as King of Kings. As he walked on earth, his promises were being seen. In the land of creation, his life sustained us all. You see, we live in a generation where we want instant instead of consistent. And for that reason, many of us have a hard time understanding the truth. As these people take you on a journey, the unknown of the childhood of Jesus will come alive as they discover the life of a Nazarene.
We're gonna see it, a village. We created and built a village, Nazareth, as it was at Jesus' time, 2,000 years ago, at the time of Jesus. We built here houses, synagogue, and an olive press, using the same kind of building materials of the first century, and the same style. We have looked at many archaeological sites here in the country in order to build everything authentic at that time.
Wow.
During the work in building this village, we found that the land that we are building the village on, it used to be a farm in the first century. We didn't know that beforehand, but we found it by accident. So we restored it. We're gonna see that also. And we've added to all these people. Our people can be dressed first century, and they will be working outside in the village with the same kind of tools of the first century.
Wow. That's
the idea here is to show you how life looked like in the first century and how the story of the Bible will be more clear when we see
Great.
The life of that time.
Wow.
That's
Very
the
cool.
idea. Ready?
Ready.
Yeah. Okay,
definitely.
Let's go.
When we got to Nazareth village, I was exhausted. I was so tired, so jet lagged. I was just trying to get through the day. You know, I walk in and it just looked like a normal building, nothing too fancy, nothing great, nothing marvelous. You know, we walk in, we meet our tour guide, and he was just this normal guy who had an accent, but he was really nice.
I mean, there's such a big emphasis on olive trees or olive oil in scripture. What do you see any correlation in maybe the teachings of Jesus of what he kind of spoke about regarding that in relation to what we're seeing right now?
Yes. You know that olive tree is, as I said in the previous station, it almost does not die. Olive tree, it renew itself all the time. It grows and new cells will be grown and it can live thousands of years. And that's why, in a way, the olive tree represents Israel.
He's taking us through all these things that Jesus did and how he lived, and you know, we start walking, and it was nothing, again, nothing extraordinary to me. We were just walking. And then I see the sheep.
We're here at the sheepfold. We have our sheep here and our shepherd, Samuel.
Hey, Samuel.
Hi, Samuel.
Samuel is our shepherd, he's our pastor. And as I said, the sheep and the shepherd will develop a relationship, very, very close relationship. And we do experience this here very much. When the shepherd, our regular shepherd, does not show up in the morning, if he's sick or something happened to him, he does not show up, and we need to replace him with another shepherd. He will be having tough time dealing with the sheep. They don't follow him. They don't understand him. They don't recognize his voice. Yeah. And they don't follow him easily. Yeah. We do experience with the real shepherd that they really know him, and he knows how to deal with them.
Wow.
Now, also the shepherd will have goats with the sheep. Now we don't have goats right now, but goats can be the same flock together with a shepherd, with a sheep. Although that they are two different animals, not only in how they look like, but also in behaving. The goats are kind of troublemakers. They don't listen to the shepherd easily. They don't follow him.
Yeah.
And the Bible says when Jesus comes back and the judgment day, what's he gonna do?
Separate
the sheep from the goat. The sheep are symbolizing the righteous people, the one that follow the shepherd and know and recognize his voice. They are his own. And the goats that are kind of away from the shepherd. They have their own way of life. So all of this again, now the Bible will come alive.
Some of the things that we've learned today is just like, you know, like seeing the sheep there and their sweetness and how they only hear the shepherd's voice. Like, it touched my heart so much because that's how God wants his children to be, you know. He wants us to just not hear anybody else's voice, you know, and the voices around us, but just be so consumed with him that we don't listen to the other voices out there, you know. And that's what our guide today said, that the sheep, they don't listen to anybody's voice. They know their shepherd, and that's the only voice they'll listen to. And it has inspired me to just stop listening to other voices, because I know my Heavenly Father, he knows the way my life should go, and he's the only voice that I should pay any attention to.
When we went to Nazareth and we walked through that whole scene that was there, we walked all these different spots. The one that I really liked also was the carpenter, when it showed the carpenter on how he did everything. And he wasn't a carpenter, he was a builder. And what they taught me was where they spoke of him not just being a carpenter. They showed us where they actually built the whole house.
This is Joseph, he's our carpenter. Hello, Joseph.
Hello, Joseph.
He's using the same kind of tools of the first century, the same kind of tools that Jesus had worked with. This tool is called an adze, E-D-Z. It can cut the wood, it can make the shape of the tool. It's really a very useful tool. Most of the work will be done by this. I guess you saw this before. It's called plane.
Yeah.
Carpenters in some parts of the world still use it until today. At Jesus' time, they had it. With this, they can peel the wood. They can make the wood flat. They're flattening the wood much more with this.
Wow,
2,000 years, for 2,000 years, the same tool, still good. And that's really something amazing.
Wow.
Now, the last tool I want him to show you is something very unique. And that is, I want you to guess, please, what you think this tool can do. So this is the tool. What is this?
A slingshot.
Bow and arrow.
Think about a carpenter tool. Something that carpenter would need to do.
To sharpen.
Look at this here.
To drill.
To drill.
Oh.
Exactly. You got it.
Nice.
A drill. Drills a hole.
Oh, wow. Look at that.
That's so
wow.
Cool.
That's the way they did it.
It may
wow.
take 2 weeks, but it works.
I
was going to say
2 weeks.
That's so cool.
Can I try
wow.
Good?
That is so awesome. All right. So I just grab it like this. Hold it right here. And then
just the top.
And then what I do?
Just hold the top here. Just the top.
Okay, so I just kind of with the wrist like that.
If you hold it all, does not move. You need to hold the top. Just the top.
Make that 6 months the way he's going.
Yeah.
Can I try?
Coming over here was, in my mind, seemed like it was going to be easy. Because, you know, I've traveled many times before. So I get on the plane and I go. And this was quite different.
We came to a synagogue here, our synagogue, replica of a first century synagogue that is unique. The first one that you can see as a whole building in the whole world, I think. There is nothing like this. In many other places you see a ruins. Half of the walls, there is no roof, but here is a complete building with everything. And this is where Jesus had preached a lot. Everywhere in Galilee, wherever he goes, he used to go to the synagogues, teaching them and speaking to them and healing their illnesses, freeing them from the devil. In Nazareth here, Jesus one day went to the synagogue. He opened the scroll of Isaiah and he found a place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me."
I think what stood out to me in looking at the way people lived 2,000 years ago, over 2,000 years ago, was they got by. They got by without the hustle, without their cell phones, without, you know, this, that, and the other. They got by, and they lived wonderful lives, and they were happy with what they did. They enjoyed their journey. They enjoyed their life. That really touched me to be able to see the simplicity of life, and yet it was a great life.
Welcome back to a TB and Salsa special program here in the Holy Land. Today we are unpacking and taking a look at this very place that Jesus grew up, located in the Lower Galilee, about 20 minutes from Nazareth. An ancient Galilean village has been recreated. We had the opportunity to get a real sense of what life was like over 2,000 years ago in the Galilee by actually becoming involved in the daily life of ancient biblical times and taking part in the various activities. And to make it even more authentic, we had the chance to wear authentic period clothing through this experience. Enjoy.
Today I feel like I learned the simple life. You know, sometimes we forget, you know, living in a place where it's so busy and you're always constantly on the go, you forget how simple life really is. If I was born in this time and age, you know, back in the day, I wouldn't have made it, not even for a second. It would have been really hard for me to live in those days. So I think God was really strategic when he placed me in this century.
So we went to Capharnaum. And we got to experience the life of Jesus. And they had us put on this whole outfit. And I had this little like turban thing on my head. And my husband did it. It was fun. You know, they set the stage really well.
Who are you supposed to be?
We're going to find out.
Guys, are you good? Do you need my assistance?
When I started this trip, I wanted to be able to discover a little bit more about the life of Jesus. So I wanted to be able to immerse myself in certain communities and places that recreate moments like that.
All the way just above the eyes.
No.
There we go.
Okay, there we go. Wait, stop moving. No, let me do it.
Yours looks nice.
Oh, mine looks pro did it.
Ladies, are you?
Can you try the again? Pro here?
Lights at the front.
It's okay for me just to stop and enjoy the moment. And today I was able to just do just that. I was able to stop, slow down, and enjoy the moment. And I am very grateful for this experience.
Guys, this is where we have the food eating during the summertime. The tent is where we have it in the wintertime. It's either this tent or the smaller one where we will probably meet. Okay, so now we turn right and say hi to Sienna. Let me just take her.
So we're milking goats today. That's what we do, apparently. Never milked a goat ever in my life. I'm from the city. I'm from Dallas, Texas. So this was a new experience all for me. I mean, he called me up. I was the first one up. So I definitely wanted to see if I could set the tone.
You know what? I'll show you how it's done and then you do it, okay? It's as simple as that. I'll assist you. Guys, we'll hold the udder and then you wanna give it a good squeeze, okay? Doesn't cause her any pain. Then again, we are milking them twice a day. You just
wait. How do you know push. It doesn't cause her any pain?
Because I tell you, because if we won't milk her, guys, if we won't milk her, then she'll be in pain. Then she'll start yelling and crying. Okay, like we are milking them twice a day, every single day. So who wants to milk?
I'll do it.
Let's go.
Go for it, Nate.
Come on,
knock yourself out.
Here we go.
Go, buddy. Go. Just.
Nate, remember we have a turn too, okay?
Don't be afraid.
All right.
And I'll sit you right down that chair.
Okay.
Ready?
One. Yeah, don't squeeze me. Squeeze the goat.
Yeah. Two.
Yes, more. Push it down. Push it down. More, more.
Be gentle, Nate.
Hold on. Hold on.
I can't have it there.
We're starting to milk the goats, and we all took turns. And at the end, I had Nate sit in front of me.
Why am I doing this?
Go, go.
Open up your mouth. One, two.
We got him. We got him.
Good girl. Good girl.
Pastor Teresa kind of put me on blast and had me sit on the seat. And, you know, this was different. I really wasn't expecting, you know, the goat to really, like, spit that milk out. But the milk shot me right here. I was down. It was just, like, man down. I was down and out for the count. So the milk got on my face. That was a funny moment. I guess everyone else laughed. I didn't. But overall, it was a great fun time. I really enjoyed the goat experience. Don't know if I'll ever do it again, but it was definitely going in the books for sure.
Today we made the pitas, and I like quesadillas. Slowly laid on top of the side.
Ooh!
Okay. The guy here will flip them and take them out for you. Let me just bring the empty tray. Let me bring the tray inside. Hold on.
No, it fell!
Oh, bread down.
Mine fell.
We lost one.
It's fine. I'm bringing all the rest of them. I'm bringing them.
No!
It's fine, guys. We have
I
more.
Grabbed the pita bread, and then it fell all the way into the fire.
Grinding the wheat was done back then by the women and children. The husbands used to work in their fields. I want you all to have a go. Try it. Have a turn.
What do you do?
You turn the upper stone on the lower one. Yeah. Either ways. Hard, right?
Very.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Listen. And the woman did this?
Yes.
Wow.
Yeah.
This is harder than a leg workout.
Everyone had to work. Folks, everyone had to work. There was no such a thing as, I don't want to do it. I'm at the computer. No. If you didn't work, you didn't eat back then.
Woo.
Okay? As simple as that.
People must have been really fit.
Try. We finally went to this place where they gave us dough. We ended up making pita breads. I thought it was almost like making tortillas at home. And they had it all on a hot plate. We sat it on there. Then with the cheese that we had milked from the goat, we put it on there and we ate it. And it was just, you know, I remember speaking to the gentleman, and it was like, these people live this way. I mean, they would go and they could make themselves some cheese and some pita bread and eat right there and be out there and doing what they were doing. It was once again, it gets back to that simplicity of life.
Oh, and then we're gonna pinch and pull it, make it as thin as you can.
This is like making a pupusa.
Right. Folks, at the meantime, take a look
Nobody
at the
knows
cheese.
What that is, but
guys, the cheese is ready.
Oh my God,
look at the
look
cheese.
At that cheese.
The cheese that we made. See?
Wow.
We make cheeses from Nazareth.
Nice.
Not really. So the cheese is here, it's waiting for us.
folks, the minute you get the pita shape, we'll just lay them slowly on top of this metal cover. It's called sarge, okay?
Okay.
We'll bake them, we'll put some hyssop, olive oil, and sesame seeds, and some cheese, and eat.
All right,
okay.
Sounds good.
Let's do it.
So, okay.
The moments at Kfar Kadim were great. We made pita, pitas with you know some of the cheese that was from the milk of the goat, and we all ate, and the food was delicious. I mean, honestly, such an amazing just meal that we all came together and got a chance to, you know, have with one another. So it was good.
The donkey ride was absolutely the funnest part about the whole experience because, you know, I've never ridden a donkey before, and I honestly, this is going to sound a little cliche, but I felt like Mary, you know. I could just picture Mary and Joseph, you know, and Joseph leading the donkey with Mary, you know, riding it, and I just felt like, wow, this is really what it felt like, you know, back in the day when you rode a donkey. It was pretty awesome.
I was with Donna. And I don't know what Donna told the donkey, because after she walked away, it started getting rebellious and stopped and felt like it wanted to buck. I don't even know if they buck, but I had to get a new one. So, but it was fun. I was pretty good. I enjoyed it.
I really feel like me and the donkey had a connection there. And I get off of this donkey, and then it's Pastor Nati's turn to ride the donkey. And I don't know if it was the weight difference or what exactly took place there, but as soon as Pastor Nathi got on this donkey, he was not a good donkey.
I've never ridden a donkey before. I don't know if you could tell. I was kind of getting off balance a little bit and trying to, you know, just make sure I don't fall. I mean, honestly, that was the whole goal. I did not want to fall off that donkey. So I didn't get a chance to fall off of it. But we ran the donkey around a couple of times. It was great. It was great. I'd never done this before, but I think I managed to do a decent job at it. So, yeah, it was fun.
So before leaving Kfar Kadim, one of the tour guides gives us a courier dove. And this dove is known to be able to be released in a certain location. And wherever you're releasing it from, it can be able to find its way back home. So we receive the dove in a box.
Folks, now I'm gonna give you the pigeon for you to release later on, okay? You'll write the pigeon note, you'll put it inside this container, and then you'll attach this container to its leg.
Okay.
When you round the leg, close it, and then dispatch the pigeon. She'll come back, we'll read your note, we'll scan it, and we'll email you your note saying she came back.
That's cool.
Okay, so awesome. Then you can experience ancient mail.
Wow.
There you go.
That's okay. Awesome.
Thank you. Thank you.
That's so cool. Thank you. So,
thanks so much.
Pleasure.
Welcome back. And as you can see, Nazareth has been quite the experience. We continue our journey within Israel and many more great experiences that were truly eye-opening and unbelievable. Watch this.
Clearly heard in my spirit. And my sheep hear my voice. And that scripture just came alive in that moment when he was explaining.
Even being here brought me into the whole thing of just settling myself and getting away from. Because prior to getting here, I was so busy with everything that I was doing, all the way up in the airport. And then once I got here, my mind has just been on Jesus here in Israel.
coming into Jerusalem was very surprising for me. I did not expect to see a city. It's beautiful. It's absolutely beautiful.
Well, that's all the time that we have for you today. Thank you for watching and for being a part of all the great things that God is doing right here in Israel. I hope that you all were encouraged to see the heights and depths of God's love for you through this journey to Nazareth. John chapter 1 says, Philip found Nathanael and told him, "We have found the one Moses wrote about in the law, and about him the prophets also wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." Nazareth? Can anything good come from there? Nathanael asked. "Come and see," said Philip. Now, God birthed something beautiful in a place that was disregarded, disapproved, and deserted, so he can show you the fullness of his love. And many of you at home may be struggling with this very thing, a difficult situation or challenge, and asking yourself, can anything good come out of this? Over 2,000 years ago, God proved this through the childhood of Jesus in Nazareth, that he can raise great things out of what may appear to be devastating circumstances. Where you are born or raised does not determine your value, your future, or your purpose. The life of Jesus proved that, so you can have hope in God's redemptive plan for your life. Once again, thank you for watching today's program. Don't forget to email us your questions and comments, and stay connected with us on social media. See you next time. God bless you.